Hello, I'm Selmateacher7, also known as Mr. Barry by my students. Today I'm going to be talking about cell phones. So if you have any of the newer Android phones, like the Samsung here, or the Motorola phones, or the ZTE Android phone, or any of the newer Apple phones, those are all considered smartphones. But if you have a flip phone, they're not considered a smartphone. So let's get started with the lesson on how to use your newer smartphone. So to start off with this lesson, I want to go over some of the terms that we'll be using before we actually start getting into our smartphones. We also want to talk about how to connect to your Wi-Fi. And we'll say a few words about Freedom Pop as well. First off, what is Wi-Fi? Many of us have an internet connection at home with a Wi-Fi signal. Wi-Fi is a technology that uses radio waves to provide a network connection. An area with a Wi-Fi signal is called a Wi-Fi hotspot. Many restaurants, libraries, and even gas stations provide Wi-Fi hotspots so that their customers can connect to the internet. Wi-Fi hotspots are normally only about as large as the building they are housed in. So you must be near the source of the Wi-Fi in order to connect to it. Okay, so what devices can connect to Wi-Fi? Well, here's a short list. By the way, just remember that the list of Wi-Fi rated devices is growing every day. But the most common devices are laptops and Chromebooks. And of course, we use browsing the internet, looking up recipes, checking your email, watching videos, listening to music, and online radio, creating new documents, etc. So basically, you can do everything on laptops or Chromebooks. Cell phones and tablets. So here we go. And you do the exact same thing. In fact, the tablets and the smartphones of today are very, very powerful computers that can do so many wonderful things. And in fact, you can check your Google Drive, your Google Photos, and do the exact same things as you would on a laptop. Wi-Fi enabled desktop PCs. Now this is a PC and it has an antenna on it there, and it's Wi-Fi enabled, and it does the exact same thing as all the others here. And some people even have smartwatches now. And of course, that is amazing. Now, other devices that connect to Wi-Fi are Wi-Fi cameras, Wi-Fi refrigerators, Wi-Fi thermostats, Wi-Fi radios, Wi-Fi water heaters, Wi-Fi security systems, Wi-Fi printers, car stereos, and the list goes on and on. The point to all this is that when you have a Wi-Fi enabled device, that device can connect to the internet and download its own updates, or give you an access point for its users to the internet, where they can find more resources, such as music, email, videos, recipes, and so on. Alrighty, so here's a list of a few Wi-Fi enabled refrigerators by Samsung. They're very expensive, but they do exist. Here's another Wi-Fi enabled refrigerator. As you can see, the tablet on it is very large. Working with smartphones and tablets. The technology used in smartphones has changed greatly in the past few years, with simpler and more ergonomically designed features. The buttons. Most cell phones and tablets today have at least two main buttons, a small power button and a longer volume control button. And here we see normally what we are talking about here. Here's the power button, is normally found on the right-hand side of the device, but a few designs have it on the top or the left-hand side. And if you have a newer LG phone, you might even find it on the back
of the device. The volume button is normally always longer than the power button and is found on the left-hand side of most devices. But again, if you have an LG smartphone, you might find that the volume control button is above and below the power button on the back of your device. Next, let's get into the home button. The home button is found at the lower portion of the face of the Android device. It may be a physical button or a button that appears on the screen. It is designed to open the home screen, where the user may find icons to make calls, take photos, or open a favorite app. And here's a few examples. If you have a Samsung, some of the Samsungs look like this. It's an actual physical button. Here's the, if you have an Amazon Fire device, it's a circle. Many of the Motorola-E devices have as a circle, as well as LG, they have it as a glowing circle. The home button found on a generic smartphone may look like a little house. Other important buttons, the back and option buttons. So we have the back and options here. These buttons are found at the bottom of the screen and allow you to go back to the previous screen and find more options. Turning on your smartphones and tablets from standby. Turning on these devices is very easy. Just tap or press the power button and then swipe on the screen with your finger. The term standby refers to the device not being completely off nor completely being on. It is in standby mode, waiting to ring when you receive a call, just like your home phones of yesteryear. Here are a few examples of login screens. So you might recognize some of these. If you have a Samsung device, your login screen may look like this. Shows you your time and date. If you have an Amazon Fire device, it'll show the time and date again. If you have a Motorola E, again, shows the time and date and some notifications there. And here's a generic Android smartphone. Please notice how all these login screens have many similar characteristics. They all have some method of unlocking the device. So on the Samsung, it said swipe screen to unlock. On the Amazon, it had this lock on it that you would swipe up to unlock. You have the Motorola E device here, and you have a generic Android smartphone here. They all have some method of turning on the camera to quickly take a photo from the login screen. So here's the camera icon found on the Samsung device, on the Amazon Fire, on the Motorola E, and a generic Android smartphone. How to turn off your Android device. To power down your Android device, press and hold the power button for a few seconds, then tap the option that reads power off on the screen. So you would press and hold the power button, and then this window would appear right on your screen, and you simply tap power off. Please note that I rarely actually ever turn off my smartphones. Working with the home screen. The home screen is the one screen on your device that loads after you log in and shows you links to many of its features. So if we look here, we see notification and status area at the top. We have an area where it has the time and the date, the weather, and the most commonly used applications here. And then you have like a shelf down here, which sits your commonly used applications, such as your calling app or your camera app. This one here is the all apps icon, so you can find all of your applications hopefully in there. This is your message app. and this is Google Chrome, so that you can find things on the internet. So here's a close-up of it here. And again, this is the phone, camera, apps icon, message, and browse the internet, Google Chrome icon. Frequently used apps are Google Photos. Now, Google Photos, we talk about this in other places, but I'll give you a quick rundown of Google Photos. Okay, this is what Google Photos looks like. Google Photos basically allows you to have all the pictures that you take with your smartphone right here instantly at your fingertips on your Chromebook or your laptop or your Windows machine. It doesn't really matter what you have, as long as you log into your Google account and click on the icon here for Google Photos. Here's the icon for Google Photos. So you'd click there, then this screen would load. Now, the pictures, the way they are, if you click on the center icon that I'm pointing to here, is Photos, and it sorts all of your pictures from the latest ones at the top to the much older pictures that you've taken in the past. And the amazing thing about Google Photos is that it puts all of your pictures there. Let's say that you have many pictures on your computer that you want to upload and save someplace. Just click on the Upload Photos icon up here at the top, and then choose which pictures you want, or even folders of pictures that you want to upload, and it uploads all of them. Some people may ask, well, how many pictures am I allowed to put on? Well, guess what? There's no limit. It's if you do high quality uploads, which is what I choose here, there's no limit on how many pictures you can put. So we know there's no limit on how many pictures you can put. You can put up, you can upload your pictures from your computer that you backed up from years gone by. And there's other options here too. People would ask, well, how do you organize your pictures? Well, it's really easy. Google Photos organizes your pictures for you. So if I click on search, it comes up here where I can look through, I can type in a word such as picnics or Thanksgiving, and I will find all the pictures that have that theme in them. And Google Photos is amazing because it can actually determine what is inside of each picture for us. Now, here's pictures of people that I know. And anytime that you take a picture of anyone, it goes in here and it analyzes and it tries to group all the similar people together. So if I click on people, here we go. Here's some of the people that it groups together for us. So I can go down this list and see people. Some people would ask, well, how do the names, the labels get here? Well, it's very easy. They're not there when you first get them, and you add them by clicking on a picture. So let's say that I have a picture of somebody here. Let's pick this person here. I'll click on that person, and it comes up and says, who's this? Add a private label to search by name. So I click here, and I type in Kevin, and I say done, and then forever after, this label is now known as Kevin. And then if I just type in the word Kevin, all of Kevin's pictures will come up. And so it makes finding pictures of Kevin very, very easily. Very, very easy. And so I can go in, and there's Kevin again. See, there he is. And he's in this group. There he is. Let's go on to other things here. This does have albums. So here we have albums. The albums are created automatically for you. And so when I took a trip down to LA, it put all the pictures together and called it Trip to LA. Now I can go in and change the name of my albums if I want to, but I'm happy with the names that with the way they are right now. But it gives the names of the albums that you see here and puts those pictures together for you. So I think Google Photos is absolutely amazing. Remember to log into your Google account on your phone as well as onto your Chromebook or on your laptop, and then that synchronizes all the pictures together so that you can see the same set of pictures both on the smartphone as well as on your computer. Another app that I use quite a bit, as you probably noticed, is my camera app. I take pictures of all my friends, and we just all enjoy that. So there's the camera app. The Play Store is where you can find more applications, and there's thousands of applications there, and many of them are free. In fact, almost all of them are free. The apps icon, where you can find more apps on your device. Google Chrome, of course we talked about that. That's where how you browse the internet. Then the notification bar is sometimes called the status bar. You find that at the top there. In fact, it is both. The notification bar is on the left-hand side, and the status bar is on the right. Then, of course, your all-important phone app. How could you make calls if you didn't have an application by which to make calls with? And that's what we have here. Okay, how to use the notification area bar. This bar normally shows up on top of your Android screen. It is divided into two areas, with the notification area on the left and the status area on the right. It is easy to find because it resides on the top of the home screen of most smartphones and at the bottom of most tablet home screens. So I've circled the notification area for you here and the status area over on this side. The most common notification area icons. Apps and messages services can drop you a note on the left-hand side of your notification area. This is the place to look to see if you have new emails, missed calls, Facebook posts, or any weather updates, etc. The following icons indicate that you've received a notification. So if you see something that says something like Facebook, that's from Facebook. Two invites from Hangouts, and their names will go right there. So if you have Hangouts is a wonderful app, by the way. I can show you that. This Hangouts is okay. To find Hangouts, you simply click on your apps icon there, and you'll find this icon. You may find it on your smartphone as well, or on your computer or Chromebook, and it allows you to make free phone calls. So you click it, and it'll say hi, and here's past conversations I had with other friends. Shows when I made those calls, and so you have free video calling from, that's worldwide, that you can call from your smartphone or your Chromebook or your Windows computer. As long as you have a microphone and speakers and camera, you can do a video call. You can also just make a regular call. Now that's calling from your device to a person's phone. And that might be their home phone or a cell phone. You can also message them if you know their email address or their phone number. You can also send them a message and then talk it back and forth that way. Now if you want to do a video call, you simply click on video call here, and the screen opens up, and then you would type in the name of the people who you want to call. So that's Hangouts. Now if you want to know more about Hangouts, I do have other videos on the topic of Hangouts and how to use Hangouts step by step. So you can, if you so desire, you can see those. If you received a call but you weren't there to pick it up, you have a missed call, and the names and phone numbers would appear in that list. Here you have applications that have been updated, and it'll tell you which applications you had on your device that were updated. So here we see 31 applications updated, Planets Live, Wallpaper, Microsoft Word, and a few other of my applications were updated. So it does tell you which ones were updated. If you receive email from somebody, or if somebody has shared an item with you, it will look like an icon like this, and you'll say the person's name and then what they've shared with you. You also have new Google Plus notification, which is very similar to like a Facebook. And maybe somebody has shared a post or shared a picture or shared a video, and guess what? It appears here. You may also have what's called a Hangout missed call. So if someone has called you with using Hangouts, it will say two missed calls, but it will show this icon for Hangouts, and their names appear there. And then this is, of course, Amber Alert. Shows you the city name, vehicle description of what to look for. If you've been downloading videos or music, it will say the name of the video or the song, and you'll say download complete when it's done. And there we go. We also have Freedom Pop set up. So if you have your phone set up with Freedom Pop or another service, you get a phone number and you'll say setup complete when that setup is complete. You'll notify you that with a green check mark. You also have device health alerts. One device one alert needs your attention. You will say something like that, and it will make a chime sound. System update downloaded. So if you've received an update for your Android system, you'll come out with an icon like this. Other notification icons. So if you have new email or new Gmail, it looks like this. Connected via a USB cable, maybe to power or to a computer, Chromebook or so, you'll have this icon. Call is in progress. You'll see this one up there. A new voicemail. So if someone left you a new voicemail, it looks like these two circles with a line connecting it. And then sync to Google Drive complete. So if you've taken pictures or if you have created files on your smartphone, then what it does is it synchronizes all of those files with your Google Drive. So everything's always updated for you. So to see the details of the notification bar, just swipe it down to reveal more information. How to use the notification bar continue. So here are now is the status. We're going to look on the right hand side. The most common status area icons. The status, let's see here, the status icons indicate the status of your smartphone. For example, it shows the time, the phone's battery, cellular signal strength, Wi-Fi signal strength, etc. And I'm not going to go through this entire list here, but these are some very common icons that you see there. The most common one for me would be mobile network strength, right there, or connected to Wi-Fi network and the strength of it there. If you have Bluetooth speakers or headset, you might see this icon here. Roaming, I see that sometimes on mine. There'll be these bars with an R on it. And if you have no signal whatsoever, it might be an X with the bars. And then, of course, battery status is here. You can receive more details from the status area by simply pulling down this area with your finger. A drop-down curtain will appear with more details. To see even more information on any notification or status icon, just tap them with the tip of your finger, as you see me doing here. To dismiss all notifications, you can tap the clear button. So there'll be a button that says clear, and you tap it and it clears all of your notifications. On newer Android phones, You can access the notification area from the lock screen now. Furthermore, you can dismiss each notification by swiping it to the left or to the right. All right, now using your smartphone, how to place a call with your smartphone. First off, log in or turn on your phone. This photo shows me holding a cell phone in my right hand as I am pressing the power on button with my right thumb and sliding up with my left hand's index finger. After the smartphone is on, you may place a call by tapping on the phone icon, which should look something like this. You may now place a call by tapping in the numbers or saying the name of the person that you wish to call, or by tapping on contacts and then finding the person that you wish to call. Okay. So here we see, this is what I'm doing here. I can tap on the microphone and say the name of one of my friends, or tap the icon down here and just key in the phone number. Now, how to set up Wi-Fi on a Wi-Fi enabled device. So this is the next segment here. The majority of Wi-Fi enabled devices are running the Android OS. So these steps will work with most cell phones, tablets, car stereos, etc. To find the settings icon, this is not the Google settings icon, by the way. You do this by looking through the apps which have been installed on the Android device. This is normally done by tapping the apps icon and then swiping till you find the settings icon. Settings icon found on a Samsung device. Settings icons found on an Amazon Fire device. Settings icon found on a Motorola E device. And settings icon is found on the generic Android smartphone. So here's all these are your setting icons, and notice there is a similarity to them all. You click on that icon, and once you've done that, then the settings window should appear as seen here. So here's the settings for your Samsung, your Fire, your Motorola, and your generic Android smartphone. Notice what's at the top. We have Wi-Fi, wireless. This would be also Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi. And so it's easy to see that's really important there. Once the settings window has loaded, tap on the Wi-Fi option. Wi-Fi options window should load. This window will show any SSID or network that is in range. Remember that the SSD is the name of your wireless network that you have. So if you were in my home, these are the wireless networks that are near my home here, or in my home. You normally would click on the one on the top, because the one on the top would be your network that is closest to you. So Wi-Fi settings found on the Samsung, Amazon Fire, Motorola E, and a generic Android smartphone or generic Android device. Now, a lot of people don't like me using device. They don't like to hear the word device. Well, just remember that these instructions apply to whether you're using a tablet, an Android stereo system, an Android refrigerator, an Android microwave oven, or a million other Android things out there. And so to keep it simple, we just call them devices. And all these rules apply to them. Tap on the SSID that corresponds to your home Wi-Fi. If you are not sure, it is normally the SSID that has the strongest signal. So here I'm clicking on the Barry.d link. If you have the security turned on within your wireless router, then you will be asked to key in the password. So here's a space for you to key in your network password. And again, it's either on the Samsung, the Amazon Fire, the Motorola E, or the generic Android. So that's what that looks like. After entering in your Wi-Fi password, tap the Connect button. If you have keyed in the correct password, then you should now be connected to the Wi-Fi hotspot in your area, and you should have access to the internet. Tap the home button to return to the home screen of your device. Next is how to use your smartphone or tablet as a camera. All right, now this is amazing. Your devices that you have out there, whether it's a laptop, tablet, smartphone, and a myriad of other devices, they all have a camera on them, as you see here. And you can take videos or pictures with these. And the technology is just amazing. The camera technology within newer cell phones has surpassed that used in low-cost digital cameras, and the photos they take are automatically uploaded to your Google Photos as long as you have installed the Google Photos app and have logged into your Google's account from that phone. You can also easily share any photo or group of photos by using the Google Photos app share tool, which looks like this. Press the power button to see the login screen. Option 1. Tap and swipe up the camera icon to the center of the screen. The camera app should load. So some people have this as an option where they actually see the camera icon and they can just start it from the lock screen. Option 2. Tap and hold the camera icon until the camera app loads. And here we can see the camera app icon. The camera app should load as seen here. Now, you might be given tips, and you can read the tips, and then after you're done reading them, you'd click on the OK button. But I'm going to talk about some of these options that we have here. So there are many options for taking the best photos. Most smartphones come with two cameras. This tool switches between the two cameras. So there's a forward-facing camera and a back-facing camera, and you can switch between those views. There's also flash on, off, or auto. That's found on many of your newer smartphones. And of course, the all-famous shutter release. You press that to take a picture. Now, just to let you know, some of the newer smartphones have gone away with the shutter release button, and they just have you tap on the picture or this preview screen here to actually take the photo. So you just tap in the middle and it takes your pictures. Here's more options. The shooting mode tool holds many options, such as single shot, best shot, best face, sound and shot, face detection, and panorama, which allow you to take photos like a pro. I normally just leave it all set to automatic so that the camera just naturally takes the best shots for me. So remember, these are not dumb cameras, they're smartphones, and they have a computer inside them, so they can actually look at the image that they're taking and take the best picture for you. Carrying on to more options. The effects tool holds many options to change the lighting effects placed in your shots. I normally leave this tool off because it naturally picks the best shot for me. Another one here, the settings tool holds many options such as burst shot. And that's where it's going to take three or four or five pictures, one after the other. So you can then choose the best one and delete the others. GPS tag. Now if you have that turned on, it knows where the pictures were taken, down to a few meters. And this is really good if you go on a trip, long distance or coast to coast trip. You leave this on, and then as you're taking pictures from the roadside or at particular places, the camera remembers where those places are. And that way, when you have them in Google Photos, you just type in Arizona or Grand Canyon, and then it brings up all the pictures that were taken at a specific location, which is just amazing. Self-portrait mode, flash options. So you have a lot of flash options there. Right now mine's on auto flash. And there's even more shooting modes down here. Once you have selected the options that you wish, now remember, you can just leave all of these options alone. Aim at your target and press the shutter release. So find what you want to take a picture of, and then click on the shutter release. Okay. Once you press the shutter release, the camera takes a photo and stores it within the phone's photo gallery. If you have installed the Google Photos app and logged into your Google account, then the photo also goes into your Google Photos gallery online. So that's kind of nice. Steps for installing Google Photos on your smartphone or tablet. So we're going to talk about these rules, or these steps actually apply to any applications that you want to install, but I find that Google Photos and Google Drive are must-haves for synchronizing data across from your PC to your smartphone. Google Photos is a great app that ties your photos you take with an easy-to-use gallery, a way to share your photos with others via Facebook, Google+, and other social media apps, and the ability to search through all of your photos by face, setting, object, date, or even location. To install Google Photos, find the app called Play Store and open it there by tapping it. The Play Store should open as seen here. So here it is opened. Tap inside the long white text box and key in Google Photos. So right here, you tap once in this place right here in the long white text box. Key in the words Google Photos. So do that. Once you have tapped in the words Google Photos, then tap on the search key once. So there's a little button there that says search right there at the lower corner. The window will change to one similar to this one. Tap on the Google Photos app to open it. So click on the icon that looks like this. It looks kind of like a pinwheel. In the next window, tap the green install button. The Google Photos app will install in a few minutes. Once it is installed, you may open it by tapping on the Google Photos app icon found within your smartphone. So there it is. Once the Google Photos app loads, it will show a window similar to this one. Now, if you have pictures like I do, it will start showing those pictures. If you have no pictures at all, it comes up with another screen here. And it says, hey, you have no pictures. So it allows you to get started with using the app. Now, next question usually comes up. They say, okay, I'm taking pictures. How to share a photo using Google Photos? So how do you share the pictures that you take with others? tap on the photo or photos that you wish to share. The photo should fill the screen as seen here. Tap on the share icon. We've talked about the share icon already once today. There it is again. Once you have tapped the share icon, the window will change to the one shown here. So you see this. And this is basically asking you, do you want to share it with your email, with Hangouts, with Facebook, with Google+, or through Bluetooth? Some people have Bluetooth printers or other places. Tap on the social media app that you wish to share with. So in this case, I tapped on Facebook because, well, everybody uses Facebook. Follow the on-screen instructions to finish sharing the photo with your family and friends on Facebook. Now, everything works perfectly as long as you are logged into your Google and Facebook accounts on that smartphone. Alrighty. Now, normally during this time in class, I usually answer a lot of questions about all of these wonderful devices and applications that you can use. Remember, we install apps by using what's called the Play Store. So that's right here. I use the Play Store, and you just, all the apps there basically are free. There's a few that are not free, but there are few and far in between. Type in what you want to find and then click on search, and you'll find the apps for you. There's also, you can search by category as well. The next segment that I have here for us is called Freedom Pop. And Freedom Pop is a wireless internet and mobile phone service provider based in Los Angeles, California. They carry a wide range of Android and Apple smartphones. They have these smartphones on sale at a fraction of the price that other carriers charge. These sales can be found by using the Groupon.com website. So you do a search for Freedom Pop once you're at the Groupon website to find these sales. There are no contracts and services can be canceled at any time. When you purchase a smartphone, you also are given a Freedom Pop account, which you can use to check your services and billing. There are many services and plans ranging from free, yes, free per month, to $30 a month. Okay, and so here's one of my smartphones. And you can see here it's 200 minutes a month and it's free. And I also have data, 700 megs a month or so and 500 messages a month, and it's all free. So if you're someone who calls less than 200 minutes on their cell phone and you like the idea of having a free monthly charge, there you go, Freedom Pop is there. Here on this bill you can see that I added two different things, like the visual voicemail at one time, and then I canceled it after I tried it out just to see what it was like. Alrighty. I'll show you a few things from Freedom Pop right now with Groupon, so I'll show you at least how you can find it. Here's the Groupon website, that's at groupon.com, and you type in Freedom Pop, and we'll see what's on sale. So they have some Samsung and other phones on sale for around $50. We covered a great deal today, from smartphones to using Google apps and other things there in our Google accounts. Please like and subscribe to my Selma Teacher channel. And thank you very much for watching. Have a wonderful day.